Studies in listen-only mode.
Hello, and welcome to Autism Start Here, What Families Need to Know, Part 3. This webinar is brought to you by Autism New Jersey and the State Department of Human Services Office on Autism. My name is Suzanne Buchanan. I'm the Executive Director here at Autism New Jersey. I'm a licensed psychologist and board-certified behavior analyst. I've been with the agency 14 years. I'm extremely passionate about helping individuals and families dealing with autism, and so it's my pleasure to bring you this webinar today. We have a few things in our agenda. We're going to be talking about the treatment decisions landscape, meaning the types of things that you should be thinking about when considering different interventions to treat autism. We'll also review Autism New Jersey's position statement on treatment recommendations, provide resources for evaluating treatments, and provide a very brief overview of what applied behavior analysis has to offer in the treatment of autism. So the first question, is autism treatable? The resounding answer is absolutely yes. While there's no known medical cure, early intervention can greatly improve abilities and quality of life. There was recently an article in the New York Times Magazine that outlined research that's been happening over the last few decades on how some children with early and intensive behavioral intervention go on to lose the symptoms of autism and be quote-unquote indistinguishable from their peers. The main point here is that all children and adults can learn new skills through highly structured and specialized educational programs. We know that teaching and treatment must be individualized and delivered in a consistent and comprehensive way. You'll never see, or you should never see, two programs for individuals with autism that look the same, because their programs should be based on a very individualized and detailed assessment and systematically help them learn new skills. So how do you find the right information about autism treatment? A recent Google search yielded 22 million results when we searched for best autism treatment. And if you can't tell the difference between the recommendations, it's very easy to go down the wrong path and waste precious time and resources, especially when there are more than 400 interventions that are currently marketed as treatments for autism. So here are some decision-making themes. And even though there's not a lot that we know about the potential causes of autism, we do know quite a bit about treatment. We know that some interventions have been proven effective, while other interventions have been proven ineffective or harmful. The overall message here is that all treatments are not created equal. We also want you to think about the following themes as we approach this topic. From an Autism New Jersey perspective, we're looking at that first question there. Which interventions are the most effective for the majority of individuals with autism? We are here to make recommendations for the broadest number of people with autism. That second question is probably for you and anyone on your child's team. Which interventions will likely be the most effective for a specific person? Okay, and so we're going to be presenting information to you that is based on our recommendations for the majority of individuals, and that we also hope will be helpful to you as you make your decisions on which interventions to try for your child. Okay, so a little bit more background here before we get into the specifics on treatment, but it's really important background information as you think about autism treatment. So why science? Autism New Jersey has decided to use science as our guide when evaluating treatment claims. Science is an objective way to gather knowledge that minimizes bias and maximizes accuracy. Right? We want to accurately identify which treatments are effective and which treatments are not. And so science provides a criteria to decide if information is valid or not. Overall, is this conclusion credible? What's the likelihood of success given this treatment and the data we have about it? And so, unfortunately, much of the information that's available on the internet and elsewhere is presented as factual when it may not be. And so science helps us differentiate or tell the difference between opinion and substantiated data, between conclusions drawn from faulty or poorly designed research versus those drawn from well-designed studies. Okay, now, just a quick note, opinions and testimonials are very important as a starting point, and they're very powerful. If you hear another parent or professional saying, this particular treatment worked for my child or worked for some of my students, you're going to be likely to try it, and understandably so. But we also want to do a little further and deeper digging into what the research literature says about a particular intervention and why your child may be a good candidate for it or not. Okay, so just like with other medical conditions, we want objective data and evidence to guide our treatment decisions, not mere theories or guesswork. Okay, a few more notes on the entire landscape of treatment decisions here. Therapy versus recreation. And actually, the title of this slide could also be therapy and recreation, right? Individuals with autism likely need both. They need therapy and they need some recreation time as well. So to the first point here, let's remember that treatment or therapy is not necessarily a matter of whether the individual with autism enjoys the activity, and often they do, and that's the best type of treatment, but that's not the sole key determinant as to whether or not something is therapeutic, right? The determination on whether something is therapeutic is based on whether or not it changes the symptoms of autism, whether or not it changes that person's behavior, whether they're talking more, playing with their brother or sister more, being a better listener to mom and dad, right? We want to see behavior change as a result of treatment. And so many activities are advertised as therapeutic, but they also have a really good place as rewards and as leisure activities. We also need to objectively evaluate if the activity is alleviating any of the traits of autism, teaching skills, or reducing challenging behaviors, as I just mentioned a moment ago. I'll take a moment to say that on any of these points, Autism New Jersey staff is available to talk with you about your individual situation and go into much greater detail than we're able to here in this webinar. So again, feel free to take notes and call us anytime. We'd be happy to speak to you. Okay, so a little bit more context here, the research to practice. When we look at what credible research suggests, we want to make sure that that research was actually conducted with individuals with autism. I personally have spoken with the proponents of many different interventions, and the proponents talk about the research base behind their intervention, but lo and behold, that research was conducted with other populations. So maybe children from disadvantaged backgrounds or children with other conditions like dyslexia or ADHD. And so Autism New Jersey has a very high bar in terms of making sure that the research backing for a particular treatment has actually been conducted with individuals with autism. Okay, and so it's also very possible that any one individual may respond well to an intervention even if it doesn't have documented proof from the research literature. Okay, so anytime we veer off from what the research suggests is our best odds, we want to make sure that data are collected, behavioral data are collected, to determine whether or not the treatment is bringing about any improvement. Again, Autism New Jersey staff are available to you. We have many user-friendly ways to suggest collecting data. And data collection, while it might sound boring, is supremely important. There are a lot of interventions going on probably in a child's life, and we want to make sure that everything that we're doing is working. And it's possible, or it's likely, that some interventions won't work, and we want to be able to identify those as quickly as possible so that we can change course. Okay, so now on our agenda, we're on Autism New Jersey's position statement on treatment recommendations. I'll go through these quickly in the interest of time. So what methods are well-researched, shown to be effective, and are recommended by Autism New Jersey? Overwhelmingly, the research supports the field of applied behavior analysis as the gold standard intervention for autism. It's a related field of positive behavior support, and hundreds of studies have demonstrated the effectiveness of ABA. Many state governments, as well as the Surgeon General in the late 1990s, have endorsed ABA as an intervention for individuals with autism because of the robust body of evidence. And we also see that research studies have documented substantial improvement even when ABA was compared to equally intensive eclectic treatment. And I'll make a note about eclectic treatment in a little while. Okay, on the medication front, we see that Abilify and Risperidone may reduce tantrums and aggression in children with autism. But before beginning any medication, the entire team should operationally define the behaviors that the medication is targeting and create a data collection plan so that you can all review the effectiveness. It's not good enough to just guess over time or try to remember back what the original frequency of the behavior was. It's much better to have objective data to look back so that we don't have to rely on our faulty memories. Okay. And it's also important to be able to closely monitor any progress or potential side effects, since individuals with autism may not be able to readily share them. Okay. Moving on to the red light section of our position statement, what methods are well researched, shown to be ineffective, and are not recommended by Autism New Jersey? These are auditory integration training and other types of listening programs. Facilitated communication, which is very different than functional communication training. And again, Autism New Jersey staff are available to talk to you about the difference. Secretin, which is a synthetic hormone, and psychoanalysis for both parents and children with autism. There's a clinical consensus that psychoanalysis to treat autism is ineffective. Okay, so what about all of the other treatments that we would consider yellow light? Proceed with caution. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm on the orange light slide. I'll get to yellow in a minute. So the preliminary evidence for these interventions shows that these are ineffective. So sensory integration, special diets, and just a quick note on special diets. Sometimes parents and teachers approach diets as what can it hurt? But there have been some follow-up studies on children who participate in these special diets. And one study in particular found decreased bone density in 8-year-old boys with autism who were on these special diets. And so any diet program should be taken on with great caution, as well as the professional advice of a nutritionist or dietitian to make sure that children are getting all the nutrition they need. Also, preliminary evidence suggests that vitamin B6 with magnesium is ineffective, and there's significant risk to chelation, which is a way to remove heavy metals from the body, as well as hyperbaric oxygen treatment. This treatment is particularly dangerous because there were 2 fatalities in Florida as a result of technician incompetence, because the oxygen was highly flammable. So tragedies like these can be avoided if you are an informed consumer of the research on autism intervention. Okay, now on to the yellow lights. The theme here is that further research is needed, also known as might be effective, but it still is virtually untested. So you have your developmental therapies, teach, social stories. You can read the list there. And again, Autism New Jersey staff are available to walk you through any of these that you may have questions about. Okay, so here's a note about eclectic programs. Sometimes they're called integrated, combination, comprehensive, or whole person models. And it assumes that several therapies combined are more effective than one, but unfortunately there's no evidence of this. And furthermore, it's unlikely that providers are expert in each component. It could also take away time from interventions that have been proven effective. And I give an example there of when 2 interventions might be contradictory. So those are all the the questions that you want to ask providers of different interventions who might be on your child's team. How do your interventions complement each other, or how do the interventions contradict each other in any way, and how can we work through that in the child's best interest? Next on our agenda, we have resources for evaluating treatments. Feel free to print this slide as well as the entire presentation and click on those links. They are a wealth of information on understanding more about treatment landscape as well as the specific research behind different interventions. And now on to our overview of applied behavior analysis. Probably the most simple definition is that ABA makes meaningful changes in people's lives through the use of procedures that have been demonstrated to work. Okay. Many people know ABA as a structured teaching approach used both to teach new skills and address challenging behavior. And there's a very wide range of different teaching and behavior reduction techniques that fall under the large umbrella of applied behavior analysis, or otherwise the science of human behavior. ABA can be implemented in many settings, and as you see in the footnote here, our publication entitled Applied Behavior Analysis and Autism, an Introduction, reviews very basic and comprehensive information actually about applied behavior analysis, and also targets some of the myths and facts about ABA. There are nationally recognized credentials to practice applied behavior analysis, and they are available through the Behavior Analyst Certification Board. There are multiple levels of certification that you'll want to look for in any provider you're choosing. So there's the doctoral level. For the BCBA, that professional is at a master's degree level. And the board certified assistant behavior analyst is at the bachelor's degree level. The BACB recently issued a new credential called the Registered Behavior Technician. This is for the frontline staff, or otherwise paraprofessionals, and they're just rolling out that program now. So the certification, as well as the registration, requires coursework, supervised experience hours, a national examination, and continuing education. For more information on certification and finding a BCBA in your area, you can look at the BACB's website at bacb.com, or you can contact us at Autism New Jersey. Here's a very brief list of some ABA-based interventions. Positive reinforcement. In a general sense, it's catching your child being good, noticing when they're having appropriate behavior, and providing some praise or another nice reward to increase the likelihood that they will engage in that behavior again in the future. Right? From a technical perspective, positive reinforcement would involve identifying a very specific behavior and providing a consequence, like praise or reward, that would increase the future likelihood of that behavior. And behavior analysts can teach you so much more about the specifics about how to implement positive reinforcement programs and all of their variations. Discrete trial teaching, or discrete trial instruction, are the basic building blocks of teaching. It involves a very clear instruction to the learner, a response from the learner, and a consequence, letting the learner know that, basically just giving them feedback on their response. As I mentioned earlier, Autism New Jersey's publication on ABA and Autism in Introduction includes myths and facts about discrete trial instruction, because sometimes people think that discrete trial instruction is all that ABA has to offer, when in fact the science or the field as a whole has much more to offer. So again, I refer you to that publication to learn more. The third bullet there talks about interventions based on a verbal behavior framework of language. So what this means is that behavior analysts categorize all communications, right, vocalizations, gestures, all types of communicative behavior based on their function, not necessarily what the person's saying. So the function could be a request, right, the person wants a glass of water. It could be a comment, oh, that's a pretty shirt you're wearing, or it could be a conversation. What movie did you see last night? And so behavior analysts approach language from a very functional perspective. And that categorization of language is used in a number of different treatment packages within ABA. For example, natural environment training, which focuses heavily on the child's motivation. And also in the picture exchange communication system, which is a communication system that uses picture symbols to facilitate language development. Next, incidental teaching is very similar to natural environment training. It captures the child's interest. The child makes a request, and the adult typically requests a slightly more elaborated response. Right? Oh, I'm sorry. Here we go. So yes, we capture the child's interest. Say they want a cookie that's on the counter, right? And maybe the child pushes mom towards the counter, kind of indicating his interest in the cookie. And maybe mom requests a more elaborated response by taking his hand and forming his hand into a point. Right? So now the child is assisted to point to the cookie. And then the child gets the cookie. Right? So it's capturing his original interest in the cookie and then requesting a slightly more elaborate or complex response. Rather than just pushing mom, now we're teaching him to point to the cookie, which of course will be much more functional for both of them in the long run. Pivotal response treatment is, again, very similar to natural environment training and incidental teaching with slightly different or additional components that enhance motivation and the child's ability to respond to multiple or different cues. Sometimes we get into a particular way of saying something, and pivotal response treatment focuses on all of the different ways that we can present instruction or materials to try to get children to attend to all of the different aspects of it. Next, we have task analysis and chaining. Task analysis is a formal list-making process where we write down all of the components of a particular skill, for example, brushing your teeth. And so after we write down all of the particular steps, we then systematically teach and reinforce each component. Functional behavior assessment is a process for understanding how challenging behavior works for an individual. And it also guides treatment development. Positive behavior support is a very comprehensive approach to treat challenging behavior and teach new skills that improve the person's quality of life. For example, if someone typically screams to get attention, we may teach them over time that you can tap someone on the shoulder to get their attention. And then that leads to a fun game of playing tag outside or going on the swings. For an older learner who might be screaming to get attention, we might teach them to tap someone on the shoulder, and then they're prompted to set the table or do the last pieces of setting the table. And then the reward for that is eating a delicious dinner with their family. Again, I realize these examples will probably seem overly simplistic to you, but for the purposes of this webinar, I'm making them brief. And again, Autism New Jersey staff is always available to you to explain any of these and give you more information. I'm also pleased to announce that the Department of Human Services Office on Autism has updated their publication entitled Autism Navigating Through the Maze. This publication provides information on all publicly funded services available to families of children and adults with autism and is a very useful resource for you. Once again, thank you for participating in this webinar. Please reach out to Autism New Jersey for any information, awareness, and training needs you may have, or to get involved with our public policy work. We look forward to hearing from you. Thank you.